In this video, we will take a deeper look at the weak force. The theory behind this force is called quantum flavordynamics, or QFD, because this force can change the flavor of particles. What we mean about changing flavor is changing the identity of a particle. Two examples of flavor change is when an up quark is changed to a down quark, and when an electron is changed into a neutrino. It is of course not possible to change particles arbitrarily, as baryon number, charge and color must be conserved, so there are some rules this force must abide to. In this video we will take a closer look at the processes caused by the weak force, such as the very important beta decays and the neutral current diagram which led to the discovery of the C boson. We will also discuss why the range of this force is so short, and the fact that the range is so short is also why we can't really experience it in the same way as the electromagnetic force or gravity, which technically have infinite ranges. In the video about QED, we started by looking at the Lagrangian of QED. This is however not really possible for the weak force, and this is related to the fact that the fundamental symmetry of the weak force is more complicated. To understand the weak force in terms of Lagrangian, one would need to consider electroweak theory, which is the combined theory of the weak force and electromagnetic force. In fact, this electroweak theory contains all the information of the weak force and the electromagnetic force combined. The simple way of explaining why you cannot write a Lagrangian for the weak force in a similar way to the electromagnetic force is because of gauge invariance. We discussed this a bit in the video about fundamental forces, but the essential part is that to keep gauge invariance means that you are not allowed to have explicit mass terms of your gauge field. In other words, your force carriers must be massless. The difference between QED and the weak force is that the QED boson, the photon, is massless, but the weak force bosons are all massive. So if you want to see the details of the theory behind this force, then let me know and we can take a deeper look at the electroweak theory. The weak force is most famously known for being the force behind beta decays. Beta decays are when unstable atoms send out high energy electrons or positrons as radiation in order to eventually reach a more stable state. There are two types of decays, the beta plus and beta minus decay. This sign refers to the charge of the particle, thus the beta minus decay is when an electron, which has a negative charge, is emitted. Likewise, a beta plus decay is when a positively charged positron is emitted. We can write the process of a beta minus decay in the following way, where a neutron N turns into a proton P plus an electron and an anti-electron neutrino. Likewise, the beta plus decay can be written as a proton P turns into a neutron N plus a positron plus a electron neutrino. Note that these neutrinos are necessary to conserve lepton numbers. This we discussed in the video about particle physics. This process is very important in nuclear physics and the decays of unstable atoms. It is fundamentally caused by the weak force. To understand exactly what is going on in these beta decays, let's dive in deeper. We will now look at the beta minus decay, but the principle is exactly the same for the beta plus decay, just the particles are a bit different. The weak force is emitted by three particles, the W minus, W plus and the C bosons. The two W bosons are the particles behind beta decays, and the negative charge is in the beta minus decay and the positive charge is in the beta plus decay. Let us write the Feynman diagram of the beta minus decay to illustrate exactly how the weak force makes this decay happen via the W minus boson. First, we have a neutron, which is changed into a proton via a W boson. Because the neutron is neutral, and the proton has a plus 1 charge, we must have the negatively charged W boson, such that the resultant charge is 0, just like the neutron which started the process. Now the proton continues its life, as usual, but the W boson has a very short lifetime and quickly decays into an electron and an electron antineutrino. Note again how the negative charge of the W boson is given to the electron. Because neutrinos are neutral and very hard to detect, we never notice them in our everyday life. Thus, if we measure this process from a radioactive substance, the Geiger counter will just measure how many electrons are produced. The weak force is also mediated by the neutral Z boson. This boson is effectively like a heavy photon. By this I do not mean that you can see it as light, but from the point of view of interactions it's very similar. Because the weak force interacts with all fermions and because the Z boson is neutral, one can take all possible diagrams of QED and then replace the photon with the Z boson. But because this boson is much heavier, it takes more energy for these processes to take place, and that is why they are rare. This boson was predicted by the fundamental electroweak theory. Now, unlike the photon, the Z boson interacts with the neutrinos, and neutrino interactions are a bit of a signature of the weak force, because it is the only force to interact with neutrinos. Because the Z boson interacts with both electrons and neutrinos, one can have scattering between the two. Thus, an electron can scatter off a neutrino via a Z boson. This was how this boson was detected in 1973. Scientists measured that the electron suddenly moved in the bubble chamber. It was as if they moved on their own, but they realized that actually this was exactly the predicted interaction via the Z boson. Neutrinos are everywhere in the universe, but we can hardly detect or feel them. And in fact, it was these neutrinos that ever so slightly could push the electrons around. Moving on with the discussion about the weak force, I would like to explain why the force is so short-ranged. The key to understanding this is the uncertainty principle and the fact that the masses are very heavy. The latter was exactly predicted to satisfy experimental results. To understand all of this, let us go back to the beta decay. Let us look at the mass situation in this simple case. So again we have that a neutron turns into a proton plus an electron plus an anti-electroneutrino. We start with a neutron, which has a mass of around 939.6 mega electron volt. Afterwards we have an antineutrino, which is more or less massless for all practical purposes, and the electron is so much lighter than the neutron, so its mass is insignificant. The proton, however, weighs around 938.3 MeV, which is a bit less than a neutron. Thus everything is fine. A bit of the mass is changed into kinetic energy, which mostly goes into the electron. So where is the problem, and what does this process have to do with the range of the weak force? If we look at the process in more detail, we see that the neutron decays into a proton and a W boson. And this W boson then decays into an electron and an electron antineutrino. The problem is that the W boson has a mass of around 80,000 MeV, thus a bit more than 80 times the mass of a neutron. It would seem like we're creating mass out of nothing. This is where the uncertainty principle comes into the picture, where the uncertainty in E times the uncertainty of T is greater than h bar over 2, where we have the uncertainty of energy and time. This is the limit of what we can measure. What this tells us is that there is a limit of how well we can know the mass of the W boson for some very small time interval. This means that as long as the process happens so fast that we cannot measure it, no problem. Thus, in other words, if the W boson decays in a time delta t that is sufficiently low such that the borrowed energy or mass, delta e, is less than what we can observe, then this process can indeed take place. So we see that in order to satisfy the uncertainty principle, the W boson must borrow a lot of energy in a very small time delta t. Since the speed of light is the limit of how fast particles can move, we can see that if the particle can only live for some very short time delta t, then obviously it cannot travel very far. If it cannot travel far, then the weak force can only interact at a very short range because the mediating bosons can't get very far. The Z boson is slightly heavier, so it has the same issues. The weak force is maybe not the most interesting force for most people, but for physicists it's very interesting because this force can do some really interesting things, like interact with neutrinos and change the flavor or type of a particle, something which no other forces can do. These facts are very important for our understanding of the universe and physics as a whole. So on that note, let's call it a day. There's of course much more to the weak force, and to get deeper into it we need to understand electroweak theory. But I hope you have already learned something new and interesting about this force. If you learned something new, let me know in the comments. Again, feel free to support the channel using the link in the description. This will help the channel a lot. If you like the video, please like, subscribe and share with your friends. In the next video, we will look at the strong force, so stay tuned.